Hi everyone, this is Lahir from ABC's of Anesthesia. Now today I'm going to be talking about one of those rare complications that pretty much most of my patients would be afraid of, and this is being awake during their surgery or anesthesia, or formerly known as accidental awareness under general anesthesia or AAGA. So let's get started. So being awake under general anesthesia, you know, during operation is obviously ridiculously scary as a concept. But it's also one of those things that seems to be more feared than even death under anesthesia. And so it really matters. And a lot of the time, this is scary because you see stuff in the popular media and in movies and TV. For example, the movie Awake by Joby Harold, starring Hayden Christensen and Jessica Alba. This is a movie about someone who is awake during some major heart surgery. And again, it's a thriller. It's got a whole bunch of stuff that's really complex in it. And you know, this is the kind of fears that patients might have when they approach me and are about to have the anesthetic. Now, obviously, there's a huge spectrum of what anesthesia is. So when we're talking about awareness under general anesthesia, we're not talking about remembering things during those minor procedures, you know, like sedation for lumps and bump excisions, or just for local anesthetic during a simple operation. And it's not really talking about as you get out of your anesthetic, you might remember something like having a breathing tube or something in your mouth. That's really not awareness as we describe it. And that's why I often mention to patients under general anesthesia that as they're waking up, as the surgery is complete, they'll feel something, or they might feel something, and they might remember something in their throat. And that just means that we're pulling out the tube or the breathing device when they're awake and ready to breathe for themselves. Now, I really think stats are important. I think it's really important to know as a clinician or as even a patient, how common are these risks? You know, this is something that's obviously serious. Is this likely to happen to me? And there's a fantastic project, the National Audit Projects run by the National Health Service in the UK. They do some amazing, massive series where they look at all these rare adverse events. And one of those is awareness under general anesthesia. And so the NAP5 study, which I'll put a link to in the story notes, kind of gives us some really good data and also some really great recommendations, as well as the things to look out for and how to prevent it. And so I'll be referring to the stats from this particular project, the National Audit Project, which is run by the NHS in the UK. And the NAP studies, they're fantastic. They look at large numbers of patients over a few years to see what happens with these rare events, whether it's awareness, airway problems, anaphylaxis, et cetera. So I'll be referring to this document. And again, it's really important to know this data because then we can have something that we can actually refer to when we're consenting patients and seeing what the actual risk is. So how common do you think awareness under general anesthesia is? So it's about on average 1 in 20,000. Now this is more for paralyzed patients in this study, about 1 in 8,000. And roughly speaking, when we've seen stats and series of, you know, when this occurs, it's always in the realm of around 1 in 10,000 or even more. So in an unparalyzed patient, the rate of awareness under general anesthesia is about 1 in 136,000. So it's, you know, most times when you're having an anesthetic, it is very unlikely that you're going to be aware. And that's one of the most reassuring things. So look, I'm giving you a lot of stats, but what do I do with these statistics? Now, when I'm trying to make a decision, you know, 1 in 20,000, 1 in 100,000, it really doesn't make much sense to me. So I really want to know, what does that mean to me as a person, and how do I make a decision based on these stats? And what a lot of us will refer back to is that, what is something that we do every day or, you know, in daily life that we do without even questioning? And, you know, can we anchor this risk and compare it to something that we do in daily life? So a lot of people would talk about the risk of dying in a car accident. Now, the risk of dying is roughly around the 1 in 10,000 mark, I think, in the UK and Australia. That number might fluctuate, but it's roughly, you know, if you drive a car for a year, then your chance of having, you know, dying in a car accident is around 1 in 10,000. And so if I think about the risk of awareness being 1 in 20,000, this is obviously safer than even driving a car. Therefore, if you drive a car without thinking, undergoing an anesthetic doesn't seem to be the highest risk. Now, obviously, it's one of those things where when you're balancing the risk, you might have a very specific circumstance. Always have your own personal circumstance in mind, and always talk to your surgeon and your anaesthetist, because there might be other factors about the surgery and about yourself that make it more or less risky. So again, absolutely go to your treating team to make sure that you're making the right choice. So if I am afraid of having this awareness under general anesthesia, how do I make a decision? And again, I think the most important thing is to go to your surgeon and anaesthetist, find the right balance. What is the risk of having awareness, or the risk of something bad happening under anesthesia for that particular surgery in your circumstance? And then think about whether that's worth it for you. For example, not having the operation is its own problem. Are you going to be willing to suffer through whatever complication or whatever problem you have and not have surgery because you're afraid of a 1 in 20,000 chance of having something. And so I think these are the questions you need to ask yourself. And hopefully with your doctor and supervising team, you're able to make a really good decision. So, I mean, the important thing to know is that no matter what we do in life, there's always a risk, whether it's, you know, driving a car, flying overseas, you know, going to work every day, or maybe even just eating certain foods that are allergenic. So whatever we do, there's risk, and it's up to you to really make a decision and be guided by good evidence to make a good decision in your circumstance. So a lot of people might not really understand what exactly happens when you go under anesthesia and you're having your surgery. And I thought I'd just clarify that. So anesthesia is actually, you know, really complex medicine where you're taking a combination of medications to make sure that you're pain-free, that you don't remember anything, or they call it hypnosis, and that you are still enough for the surgeon to operate. So we talk about the anesthesia triad being, you know, analgesia or pain relief, making sure you're not, you know, uncomfortable, that you don't remember anything, hypnosis, and that you're still enough for the surgery to occur safely, which is paralysis. So when I think about anesthesia, each procedure that you have needs a combination of these. For example, some procedures just need a bit of analgesia. For example, if you're having a little lump removed from your, you know, like a mole removed from your hand, you might just need some local anesthetic in the skin, and that provides you with analgesia, but you remember everything and you're not paralyzed. The surgery is small and doesn't require that. Sometimes you might just need a bit of sedation. For example, if you're having a gastroscope, so that's where they put a telescope down your throat, you might need a bit of sedation with something like midazolam or propofol, which essentially mean that you don't remember much, but you might remember some things. But again, because it's only a minor procedure that doesn't have any massive operative problems, doesn't have a big incision, you probably don't need large amounts of analgesia, and you definitely don't need paralysis for most of those procedures. And then there's other operations that are really big and, you know, require a full general anesthetic. For example, if you're having your gallbladder taken out or having a bowel operation, cardiac surgery, a whole bunch of other major operations, you need a lot of analgesia. You definitely don't want to remember all that stuff happening to you, and you need to be paralyzed to make sure you're not moving inappropriately for the surgery. So then my job as an anaesthetist is really to take the surgery and consider that, look at you as a patient and any medical problems you might have, and including things like, you know, your age, how much you weigh, your gender, and a few other factors, you know, your heart and lung function. And then I can tailor the anesthetic for you for that surgery. And again, for that surgery, it could be anywhere from just a bit of light anesthesia where I'm not giving you too much anesthetic because you don't need it, to higher, deeper levels of anesthetic until I get to a full general anesthetic. And there's a spectrum that you could be on, and the anaesthetist will tell you about that. And that's a part of our job, being able to communicate that. Now, you know, to be an anaesthetist in Australia, you do, you know, 4 to 6 years of medical school, 2 to 3, maybe even longer, of just general medicine. And then after that, you do 5 years of specialty training. So there's a lot of work that goes into just balancing and knowing how to make sure these medications are working in the right way and that we treat the problems of those medications as well. I've got lots of videos on the channel just about that. So let's say I do a standard anesthetic for a gallbladder operation where, you know, someone's got a biliary colic and they need their gallbladder taken out. So essentially, most people would give a dose of propofol, which gets you off to sleep. It'll give you some analgesia like fentanyl, and then also give you a paralytic. Now, after that point, those medications are working for a certain period of time. To keep you asleep, I might keep giving you propofol through an infusion driver or run some gas, some volatile gas, and measure that at the right level to make sure you're asleep. Then I, you know, make sure once you're at the absolute right level, then the surgeon usually says, hey, ready to start. And if everything's absolutely fine, I'm looking at my monitors, making sure that everything's good, then I say, yep, ready to start. And so only when you're absolutely ready does the surgeon start with the procedure. So what do anaesthetists do to try to prevent awareness under general anaesthesia? So what we do, we look at a whole bunch of things, a whole bunch of factors. For example, we know your circumstance as a patient and we know what the surgery is. So I'll tailor my anaesthetic based on your circumstance. And then I'll look for lots of clinical signs. For example, I'll look to see if you're flushed, if you're sweating, or if you have tears around your eyes. That's one of the kind of weaker signs that you might see if someone is aware. Other things will be monitored. For example, your heart rate and your blood pressure. Now, those are monitored continuously throughout the whole time. And I'll be there for every moment of that surgery to make sure that everything is, you know, going well. And so if the heart rate rises, the blood pressure rises, that's something we'll always check to make sure that, you know, you're absolutely deep enough with the anesthetic. If the patient isn't paralyzed, then you might see an increase in the respirate. And again, as soon as that happens, you know that the patient might need a bit more analgesia or anesthetic as well. So again, lots of signs tell you what's going on. Now, one of the things that could happen is the patient could move. And often wrongly, the whole theater team doesn't really understand that movement is separate from consciousness. So the body has a lot of reflex movements that can occur, but this doesn't mean that the patient's conscious. So If movement happens, it's often a really good precursor that the patient isn't deep enough, and that's not a problem. You just have to give more anesthetic and try to make sure that the patient is deeper next time. So, you know, movement during surgery occasionally happens. It probably shouldn't, but, you know, if it does happen, you just need to give more anesthetic to make sure the patient doesn't move. But just remember, that's most likely just a reflex movement and doesn't mean that the patient's actually conscious, because they've already got enough anesthesia to be unconscious. So this is one of the beautiful things about medicine and the body's physiology, is that the amount of anesthetic to make sure that you're asleep is probably a bit less than the amount of anesthesia that you require to stop moving. So that's just one of those nuances to make sure that we, you know, we've got a safety margin with that as well. Now, one of the other things that we do is have awareness monitors. Now, probably one of the most tried and tested awareness monitors is having a really good level of end-tidal volatile gas. So if your patient is asleep with volatile anesthesia, how much is going into the patient and also how much is coming out. That's called the end concentration of volatile gas, which is the end tidal volatile concentration. It really just means that the end of a tidal volume. So as you do that, that's your tidal volume. A gas monitor measures that concentration and gives you a reading. Doing your training, which is called minimum alveolar concentration, or MAC. And as long as the MAC is high enough, seven has been shown in that means that you're probably unable to remember what's going on. Now, I've always got to clarify that. That's probably not for absolutely every single person, but in big studies, it shows that that's a pretty safe level of anesthesia to prevent any kind of awareness. So volatile gas is great. This is really easy to measure because we've got the gas analyzers. So that's a really good way of making sure that your patient is not going to be aware. The other thing you might be doing is running a propofol infusion. So instead of having the gas keeping you asleep, you'll have liquid through a drip keeping you asleep. Now, the problem with that is, you can't measure how much is in the blood very easily and in real time, like with the volatile gas measurement and analyzers. So that means that we use these very special pumps to dial up a concentration to be in your plasma, and using some fancy mathematical modeling, it can titrate how much liquid goes into your body to keep you at a certain level. Now, that's not absolutely perfect, because all you're doing is you're doing some fancy maths to make sure that what you're doing is correct. But there's always a chance that things could get disconnected, or maybe this patient needs more, or maybe their physiology is different. So in that sense, it's more risky for awareness under general anesthesia to run the liquid than it is to run the gas. Now, one of the other monitors that has kind of come out pretty new is called the entropy monitors. And these awareness monitors include entropy as well as BIS. Now, these are both trade names for the particular monitor, and I'll do a bit of a demonstration soon as well. So this particular monitor, this is a BIS module. I'm just going to plug this cable in into this little spot over here. So this is the monitoring device. And there's, you know, the particular one we use, there's another one called Entropy as well. So what you do, essentially open the pack. And you get this little device that looks like this. And this just sits across the forehead, and I'll just demonstrate that now. Now, if you're a patient, what you might find is that people will just do this and just clean the surface of your skin before they apply it. Now, it's a little bit prickly. You'll feel someone just pushing down lightly on this. And then hooking it up to this monitor over here. And so you'll see that it says checking sensor, and it automatically does that. And you'll get these ticks, and then it'll read out what your reading is. Now, most of the time, you'll see that that's a modified or, you know, summarized EEG reading. You'll take the time to read that and then give you a number between 0 and 100. It not only has this signal index, but also an electromyogram there saying poor signal. That's probably just because I'm moving around and it's just trying to get the reading. And now it's got a provisional reading of 97, which means I'm very awake. So really, the levels here are anesthesia is generally between 40 to 60. And most of the time, if I'm running An anaesthetic, I want the patient between 40 and 60. 60 to 80 is sedated, and 80 and above is generally the patient might be awake. Now, if you want really deep anaesthesia, this is generally below 20 to, 20 to 40, and below 20 is called burst suppression, where you've got very little brain activity because you have so much anaesthetic on board. So I think a lot of these things are really reassuring. For example, the rate of awareness under general anaesthesia is very, very low. Also, the fact that the anaesthetist is with the patient for the entire period that these surgeons are operating. So we're there looking at every single beat of your heart. We're right there to look at any problems and sort them out really quickly. And we've got lots of monitors at hand. So we've got your heart rate, your blood pressure, your respiratory rate. We're watching those the whole time. And we've got end-tidal volatile concentrations, as well as these fancy monitors, which are pretty good at giving you this kind of reading and just an extra level of security as well. So that means that really there's very few circumstances where your rate of risk of awareness is going to be extremely high. So the next question is, especially for those practicing anaesthetics and just learning this, when is your patient at high risk of having awareness and the general anaesthesia? And this NAP study, NAP5, went through some of these risk factors. Now there's certain drug factors, which means having a neuromuscular blocker, thiopentone use, and also total intravenous anaesthesia. Obviously with TIVA or total intravenous anaesthesia, you can't measure that concentration in the blood perfectly accurately. Therefore, there's a high risk of all the reasons we mentioned before, disconnections, as well as not being able to really know exactly what that concentration is in the body. Neuromuscular blockers are obviously because if the patient's paralyzed, you're not going to see those movements happen before the patient is aware. So they highlight some patient factors being female, gender, age, so not children, but the lower adult range, as well as obesity, previous accidental awareness under general anesthesia, as well as potential difficult airway. And potential difficult airway is always a risk because suddenly, because you're trying to manage the airway, manage the oxygenation of the patient, then it's far more likely that you won't be having time to give those anesthetic medications inhaled. So you'll need someone specifically for keeping the patient asleep. So if I expect someone to have a difficult airway, I'll want someone just on the anesthetic while I'm doing the airway. You really want to be able to divide those tasks up to make sure that your patient has someone managing their, awareness state, as well as the hemodynamics, and someone else managing the potential problems of a difficult airway. There's some particular subspecialties that are higher risk. So obstetrics is higher risk, cardiothoracics is higher risk, and any real emergency operation where you have very fragile patients, you'll have to try and limit the amount of anesthetic you give them to keep them safe as well. So there's always that higher risk in those situations. There are also some situational factors to be completely aware of, which means if your patient is having an emergency crisis, that's at high risk of awareness, as well as out of hours operating and junior anesthetist. So make sure in these circumstances, you're really watching yourself and make sure that you've got someone else thinking about these things as well. So in these circumstances, make sure you're thinking about accidental awareness and doing things to manage that as a problem as well. So thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video and I hope it gave you some insight into anesthesia and the risk of being aware under anesthesia, and that it's a very low risk and that there's a lot of things that we do to make sure that our patients are safe. So if you like this video, please share with anyone who might be interested, and see you next time. Thanks a lot for watching.